I just want to say one word to you. Just one word. You listening? Plastics. There was a great future in plastics, and the Remington Arms Company was going to be all over it. Thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today, courtesy of the Dutch Hillenberg Collection, we are taking a look at a Remington Nylon 66. This is not a rare gun, it's not an exotic gun, but I think it's a gun with a really cool backstory. It represents a gamble taken by the Remington Arms Company. Actually, a really big gamble, and a gamble that paid off tremendously well for them. So, the backstory here is, going into the 1950s, Remington didn't really have a good, inexpensive 22 caliber semi-auto rifle in its catalog. It needed something. And it wanted this new rifle to be cheap to manufacture. It wanted to have a good profit margin, something that it could use to really effectively compete against the other 22s that were out there in the market. This is a huge market for a rifle. This is a plinking rifle. It's a recreational rifle. It's a rifle you throw in the back of your truck when you're going out fishing. It's a kid's rifle in many cases. There's a huge potential market for this, and Remington wanted to fill that need. But they wanted it cheap. So they looked at the stereotypical 22 caliber rifle to try and figure out where they can cut costs. The barrel, not much you can really do with the barrel, or not much that they saw they could do with the barrel. The bolt is another expensive part, but they didn't really see any way to simplify or cheapen the bolt beyond what was already being used for a plain blowback rimfire 22. And that led them to the stock. The wood handguard and the wood buttstock, the furniture of a 22 caliber rifle, was a place where there was a real potential for savings. You wouldn't think that the wood stock on the gun is particularly expensive, but when you've whittled everything else down to a lot of very simple machined parts and very simple stampings, the wood actually remains as one of the higher cost items. And Remington took a look at this and thought, plastics. Now, since the 1930s, the Remington Company was actually owned by DuPont. DuPont is a massive, is and was, a massive chemical conglomerate, and they had done a lot of research into polymers. They'd in fact come up with this thing called nylon. In particular, nylon 6-6 was one of nearly 100 different polymers that was tested by DuPont in the 1930s, and fiber 6-6 turned out to be really good, and DuPont would make a tremendous amount of money making these things for women's stockings. They were so common that they actually acquired, they're one of those products that acquired its own brand name as a generic, nylons. Well, nylon is actually the polymer material that was used to make those stockings, and Remington engineers decided that they could use that same nylon to make furniture for their new rifle. In fact, not only would they use it to make the furniture, they made it to use the entire darn thing. This looks like it's got a metal receiver, but it actually doesn't. It has a little sheet metal cover that's screwed onto the middle of the gun so that it looks like it has a metal receiver so that people don't freak out quite so much as if they thought the whole gun was just one big lump of plastic, which it pretty much is. Remington designed their new rifle, which they would call the Nylon 66 after its material, to use essentially a single monolithic polymer everything. The handguard, the receiver, the buttstock are all one continuous piece of polymer. It was going to be molded in two halves, left and right, and then put together, welded, or fixed together into one piece. And when this was being done in the mid-1950s, allegedly, the mold used to create the Nylon 66 was the most complex and most expensive polymer mold in the world at the time. And when we get into this, if you look at all the levels of detail and reinforcements and everything in this receiver, you can certainly understand how that could easily be the case. And Remington knew that this would be potentially a hard sell to their customers. Even today, we see people in some cases, looking at a monolithic polymer receiver and thinking, well, that's going to be really fragile, it'll never work right. Remington wanted to make sure that their gun was substantially durable, that it could withstand things that, say, other companies' wooden furniture's rifles couldn't. And so they put an immense amount of testing into this rifle. Between 1955 and 1958, when the first production batch was actually manufactured, they tested many of these rifles, hundreds of thousands of rounds. They sent them out to representatives, to sales reps, to use and abuse and report back. And the reports were glowing. A lot of the sales reps wanted these things right away. They did all sorts of nasty things to them. They threw them in lakes. They drove over them with trucks. And the Nylon 66 turned out to be a remarkably durable and reliable, effective little rifle. So the first batch became available for sale to the public in January of 1959 for the price of $49.95. And it would go on to be produced for decades in massive numbers. But first, before we talk about the end game of the Nylon 66, let's take a look at how it actually works, because this is pretty cool inside. Let's go ahead and dig into this. First off, we have a weird receiver marking on this one, because this is actually a special commemorative edition celebrating Remington's 105th anniversary. Note that that's the anniversary of the name. They went through at least a couple of bankruptcies during that time, but there would be a series of occasional special editions of Nylon 66 sold. But the only thing different about this is the fact that they stamped this marking into the side. Otherwise, mechanically, it's the same as all the rest of them. We have a Remington mark and caliber. These are 22 long rifle on the top of the barrel. There is no serial number on this rifle because, well, it was made in 1966, and federal law didn't actually require serializing rifles until the passage of the Gun Control Act in 1968. Apparently, Remington saw what was coming because they started serializing Nylon 66s in 1967, but that still leaves about 8 years of the initial production where just the act of stamping a sequential serial number on the gun would be enough additional cost that they opted not to do it. The controls are very simple. We have a safety here on the back tang of the receiver. Red is fire. No red is safe. We have a plastic charging handle here that pulls the bolt back. The magazine is actually located in the buttstock, so you take this, turn it about 90 degrees, and pull it out. There we go. Got a little spring-loaded follower there. To load the magazine, you just drop 22 caliber cases nose first down into that magazine tube, and then put the follower back in after it. Exact same system as the Spencer and a number of other guns, especially ones before World War II. 22s used this style of magazine. The rear sight is a very simple little spring sheet metal sort of rear notch. You can adjust this screw to move it up or down, but there are no specific settings. And we've got a big old blade front sight there. Oh, and the cap on the grip is marked Remington Nylon 66. Notice how they did go ahead and add some black streaking into the polymer of the receivers to kind of make it look like wood grain. And they did a decent job on that. It's more natural looking just at a glance from afar than a, you know, just a plain solid matte or solid color polymer. They also added this fake checkering. I suppose it's real checkering, but it's molded in. It's not actually cut. And that just duplicates what you would normally expect to see on a wood-stocked rifle. However, we have a very obvious seam that runs the entire length of the receiver, top and bottom. Now, let's get this apart. We're going to start with these two screws. By the way, you would normally look at that screw on a gun like this and go, aha, that's what's holding the stock onto the action. In this case, you're wrong. That's actually what's controlling the headspace of the rifle, which is, yeah, we'll get to that in a moment. Anyway, these two screws just go through the receiver. There we go. Pull those out. I now also need to remove the charging handle, which is done by just pulling it out the side of the gun. This is really simple, cheap plastic. And then I can lift the quote-unquote receiver off the gun. So now you can see that this is one solid piece of polymer. This guy is just a little sheet metal shell that sits over the top to look like metal and has the rear sight riveted on. You may have seen this guy fall out the side of the gun. That is the ejector. It sits right here, and it is, in fact, held in place by the faux receiver. So that little tip right there is what catches the rim of the cartridge and ejects it out the side of the rifle. This guy right here is basically a feed ramp It's going to ride up the top of the barrel here and ensure that a cartridge, which is going to come up through this tube, you can see the tip of the follower there, cartridge is going to run smoothly into the chamber. This guy prevents that cartridge from lifting up and coming too high. Now, the barrel is locked into the receiver assembly by this stirrup, and that stirrup is held in place by this big screw on the bottom. So if I unscrew this, you can see that stirrup lifting up right here. We can take the screw out. This stirrup is sort of locked in place a little bit by the barrel. I can't actually remove it until I take the barrel out. And here's, this really is a polymer receiver. We're used to a barrel being fixed to a metal receiver that the bolt then rides in. In this case, that's a nope. I can just slide the barrel forward and right out of the gun. There you go. Barrel's removed. And now I can pull out that locking stirrup. It's got a little metal plate on it as well. Now, the way this bolt actually works is, interestingly, actually rather like a lot of open bolt to closed bolt submachine gun conversions. So we have a bolt here and we have a striker here. And when I cycle the bolt, the striker is going to come to the rear and get caught by the sear and held back. There we go, like that. Now, I'm not going to dry fire this, but when you pull the trigger, this striker snaps forward. You can see it's spring compressed right there, and it's going to hit the firing pin right here. That firing pin can move back and forth just enough to fire a cartridge. It's prevented from going too far forward by that pin, which blocks it from going forward there. You can see the firing pin right there at the top of the bolt face, and that's how it fires. Like those semi-auto SMG conversions, this has two basically nested recoil springs. You can see the striker recoil spring there, and then inside this tube is a smaller diameter recoil spring that pushes the bolt forward independently. Now, let's pull the bolt out, and I can show you all those parts. So I'm going to pull this back a little bit, take tension off the charging handle. There we go. So the charging handle comes out, and then with the barrel removed, the bolt and the striker are just going to come right out the front of the receiver. Here's the bolt. There's its guide rod. There's the striker. There's our striker spring, the guide rod in between, and the bolt spring right there. So the bolt spring is going to sit over this guide rod inside that tube, and this also sits outside that tube. So there's the whole assembly put together. You can see that there are two, well, there's one rail on each side of the bolt and the striker that they ride in. And this is just a 22. It's intended to be a really cheap gun, and so there's no metal reinforcing there. There's just rails in the polymer that those two parts ride in. We've got our trigger assembly down in here. So essentially what happens is this bar is preventing this sear from dropping down. When I pull it forward, that sear will drop. That sear is holding on to this angled surface of the striker. So as soon as it can drop, the striker is pushed forward under spring pressure. That top little lug right here, where you can see the imprint of the firing pin, that's what hits the firing pin. And then we have our extractor right there. There is a semi-auto disconnector in here that resets it so that it won't fire full auto. And that's pretty much it. There's the magazine tube coming up from the buttstock. Now, we talked about this being a very complex mold to put together, and you can see from all of the recesses, the holes for the charging handle, the ejection port, the rails inside, this indeed is a very complex piece to mold, especially given just how long it is, ensuring that you don't have warpage that's going to render it the part unusable. This was a serious engineering challenge for Remington, and it's really impressive that they pulled it off as well as they did. One of the things that was done with a Nylon 66 right after they came into production, almost certainly as part of an advertising or promotional push for Remington, was a guy named Tom Fry used three of these rifles to beat Ad Topperwain's record for shooting thrown blocks out of the air. So the idea here is you take a, I believe it was a 2-inch square wooden cube, and throw it at a specific velocity and elevation and direction away from a shooter, and a shooter hits, well, fires and tries to hit the block in midair. This was done with 22 caliber rifles. Ad Topperwain made some, you know, tens of thousands of hits. Well, Tom Fry used three Nylon 66s to beat that record in 1959. Over the course of 13 days, shooting 8 hours a day, he hit 100,004 wooden blocks in a row. I think he missed four of them or eight of them over the course of that entire two-week period. So just another element that Remington put out there in the public media to show the durability and the accuracy as well, and the shootability of the Nylon 66. Ultimately, the Nylon 66 would remain in production until 1987, so a run of nearly 30 years. And during that time, 1,050,052 of them, or thereabouts, were manufactured in total. The vast majority are rifles just like this one, the Mohawk brown color, and really, they didn't change anything. They just kept cranking them out. And with the nylon polymer mold, this was a really cheap, high profit margin gun for Remington. It was a huge success for the company. They would have a variety of special editions over the years. They had an Apache black version. They actually initially offered the gun in Mohawk brown like this, or Seneca green, which was really a pretty dark greenish color. Seneca green turned out to be not all that popular. It was discontinued in 1962. The black was available for a short time. There would actually be a Nylon 76 lever action version of this rifle that was also made. And they also made a series of bolt action versions, one single shot, one with an under the magazine or an under the barrel tube magazine, one with a detachable box magazine. Those actually are constructed differently. They had metal receivers in them to work with the turn bolt action. Those were sold as well based on the marketing of the Nylon 66 because they looked the same on the outside. But ultimately, these things would become an iconic, very common 22 caliber, you know, general purpose, plinking and recreational outdoors rifle for an entire generation of people. So I think this is a really cool example of non-traditional materials and how a company tried to, and did, in fact, adapt the gun to fit their market and develop something cool using a new method. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this as well. Thanks for watching.